Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents So Much Things to Say, The Oral History of Bob Marley, by Roger Steffens. Introduction by Linton Kwesi Johnson. Read by Roger Steffens. Livication. To the ineffable Cece Smith, co-founder of The Beat magazine, devoted friend and partner, without whose efforts on my behalf this book would never have existed. And to my beloved wife Mary and our children Kate and Devon, whose constant support and tolerant overstanding are a gift from Jah. There are no facts in Jamaica, only versions, old folk saying. Introduction. The People Speak by Linton Kwesi Johnson. In an essay I wrote on the lyrics of Bob Marley's Exodus, voted album of the 20th century by Time magazine, I said of his lyrical genius that it was based on his ability to translate the personal into the political, the private into the public, the particular into the universal. Genius, it can be argued, is not merely an exceptional personal attribute, it is historical in the sense that it becomes manifest when there is a conjunction of the biographical and the historical. The second half of the 1970s, the period when Bob Marley began to reap the rewards of his long apprenticeship as a musician, was a time of turbulence not only in Jamaica, but around the globe. The Cold War was at its most intense. Proxy wars were being waged between East and West in developing world countries. Anti-colonial wars were still being fought in Africa. There were anti-imperialist struggles taking place in South America. Jamaica was on the brink of all-out civil war as the opposition, aided and abetted by the CIA, sought to wrest power from Michael Manley's democratic socialist government. Bob Marley almost lost his life during that conflict. His music is resonant of that period. It reflects the zeitgeist. At the apotheosis of his career, he had become a kind of Che Guevara of popular culture. I have the dubious distinction of having written a critique of Marley's rise to fame at a pivotal time in his career. As a fan of the Wailers' triumvirate of Bob Marley, Peter Tosh, and Bunny Wailer, I was deeply disappointed when they went their separate ways. Then, on top of that, Marley was being hailed in the rock music press as the new King of Rock, following the release of his first solo album, Natty Dread. As far as I was concerned, that was a travesty, and I was not alone in harboring such sentiments. Bob Marley was, after all, a top-ranking Jamaican reggae artist who belonged to the world of black music and was being appropriated by the white rock world. In the article I wrote titled Roots and Rock, The Marley Enigma, published in Race Today in October 1975, I not only criticized the way Marley was being marketed, I laid the blame at the doorstep of Chris Blackwell, founder of Island Records. Back then, I was a 23-year-old sociology undergraduate, and I had just published my second book of poems, Dread, Beat, and Blood. 3 years later, I was signed to Island Records by Blackwell, and a year after that, by Marley, to Tuff Gong. With the benefit of hindsight, I can say that my analysis of the marketing strategy was more or less correct, even though the sentiments were misplaced. When it became clear that Bob Marley would not recover from the cancer he was battling, the newly elected Jamaican government, led by Edward Seaga, awarded him the Order of Merit, the nation's highest civilian award. It was in recognition not only of Marley's enormous popularity in Jamaica, but also of the kudos he had brought to the nation by his achievements abroad. No other Jamaican has done more to boost the brand name Jamaica. As reggae music's greatest ambassador, Marley made an enormous contribution to its globalization and its impact on popular culture around the world. Since his demise, he has grown in stature from superstar to legend to iconic status, a remarkable achievement for someone from such a humble background. The astute and at times obscene marketing of Marley as a brand cannot detract from the fact that no other recording artist in the late 20th century, in any genre, has had the global reach and influence that Marley has, continuing into this millennium. The Rastafarian soul rebel, armed with his distinctive voice, a guitar, a great backing band, and fine backing vocals, was a man on a mission to challenge the isms and schisms of principalities and powers as he fought against spiritual wickedness in high and low places. His legacy of catchy, danceable songs of defiance, resistance, rebellion, love, and hope continues to reverberate around the world. His lyrical and melodic genius guarantees the contemporaneity of his music. What kind of man and musician was Nesta Robert Marley? Many books have been written about him, including a Marley reader for the Academy. He has appeared in fiction, too. What makes Roger Steffens' So Much Things to Say, The Oral History of Bob Marley, unique is that the author does not present a portrait of the artist through his own lens, but instead presents us with a collage of impressions seen through the eyes of others. For many years, Steffens has traveled the world telling Marley's story with his illustrated Life of Bob Marley lecture. Here, he allows those who knew Marley to give their versions. Roger Steffens, writer, broadcaster, and photographer, a respected scholar of reggae, and renowned archivist specializing in Bob Marley recordings and ephemera, has put together 75 interviews with people close to Marley who speak candidly about what they witnessed of the singer's life and times. The respondents range from people who knew Marley intimately to those who crossed paths with him, including family, friends, musicians, record company personnel, journalists, photographers, and filmmakers. The evidential nature of this book, with at times conflicting narratives, guarantees a riveting listen. Some of the testimonies confirm what was already known. Some offer different versions. Some contest myths about Marley. Others say more about the witness than the man. There are some startling revelations and contentious claims. We hear from Clement Coxsone Dodd about the young Marley's time at Studio One, the reputedly mafia-connected Danny Sims on his dealings with Marley and Johnny Nash, Bunny Wailer on his friend's composition technique, Beverly Kelso, an original Wailer, on the relationship between Rita Marley and Bob, Joe Higgs on his schooling of the original Wailers and Marley's character, Dermot Hussey, Jamaican broadcaster and musicologist, on the interview about the breakup of the Wailers that Marley wanted destroyed. There are interviews with all of the original Wailers. Other voices include Sadella Booker, Marley's mother, Cindy Breakspear, former beauty queen and mother of Damien Jr. Gong Marley, Alan Skill Cole, Marley's close friend, Third World's Cat Coor, and Rastafarian guru Mortimer Plano. Steffens sometimes makes editorial interventions, introducing a speaker or providing context for what is being said. He rarely opines, allowing his witnesses to tell their stories in their own words, structured chronologically from Marley's childhood to his demise. The overall impression we get of Marley is that of a man of some complexity, taciturn and jovial by turns, worldly and spiritual, a sleeping lion capable of violent rage, a peacemaker, a ladies' man, and a man of prodigious generosity. The most striking observation that emerges from several witnesses is how serious Marley was about his art, his single-mindedness, and his consummate professionalism. Marley's story is a poignant one of humble origins, privation, struggle, survival, trials and tribulations, triumph, and tragedy. Preface. There are, it is reported, over 500 books written in many languages and published all over the world about the Reggae King. So, why this book, and why now? What's left to say? To provide the proper answer, allow me to explain how this music lover became so deeply involved in researching Bob Marley's unprecedented life and impact on the world. I have been a fan of the Wailers' works since discovering them through a revelatory 1973 Rolling Stone article by Michael Thomas, who said that reggae music crawls through your bloodstream like some vampire amoeba from the psychic rapids of Upper Niger consciousness. That unforgettable sentence sent me rushing out the door of my Berkeley apartment to find Catch a Fire, the Wailers' first international album on Island Records. The following evening, I saw The Harder They Come, Jamaican director Perry Henzel's exuberant film, which brought the imagery of reggae and Rastafari to the outside world. My life has never been the same since. As a fan, I sought out others who had caught what Peter Tosh called reggae myelitis. Among the first teacher mentors I discovered was a man from Kingston named Ruel Mills, who had a small record shop on Fillmore Street in San Francisco called Trenchtown Records. There, he introduced me to the likes of Count Ossie and the mystic revelation of Rastafari, Ross Michael and the Sons of Negus, Alton Ellis, the Techniques, Slim Smith, and a host of obscure singers and musicians whose ethereal works moved my heart and elevated my consciousness. In 1976, after moving to Los Angeles, my wife Mary and I traveled to Jamaica hoping to find records I had only read about, mainly in British magazines such as Black Music and in occasional Jamaican publications such as Swing Magazine. We arrived the week that Prime Minister Michael Manley declared a national state of emergency, throwing the opposition into prison with no charges and placing tanks on all the island's crossroads. I felt like I was back in Saigon during the Tet Offensive. We spent most of our time in the bucolic area around Lucy on the northwest coast of the island, but we just had to go to Kingston to check out the Wailers record shop, as well as Randy's and Joe Gibbs's emporiums on the main square of Parade. Our first stop was on a deserted back street where Marley had a tiny shack. There, within 2 minutes on the ground, one of the biggest reggae stars at the time tried to pick my pocket. A half hour later, we found ourselves in Jimmy Cliff's house with some of the most important musicians of the era, revealing the best and worst of life and yard, as the locals referred to their island home. 2 years later, I met Hank Holmes, an avid collector of omnivorous tastes, who had amassed over 8,000 ska, rocksteady, and reggae records without leaving Los Angeles. We became instant friends. I thought, with his vast collection and knowledge, we could do a great radio show together, as there was no reggae on the air in L.A. at the time. We fought for a year unsuccessfully to find a station willing to let us reveal the great wealth of music being created just south of the U.S. Finally, we found a spot on a tiny NPR station in Santa Monica, an L.A. beach city, called KCRW. It had only 110 watts at the time, but there were great plans afoot for it to grow. The station itself was in a tiny converted classroom in a junior high school across the street from the license holder Santa Monica College. KCRW was always desperate for monetary support. During the first fundraising drive while we were there, they gave us an extra hour to beg for money, 3 hours on a Sunday afternoon. That day, we made history, amassing in those few hours what the station's previous fundraising drive had made in 10 days. Immediately, our airtime was doubled to 4 hours a week, and our reggae beat show became, according to the LA Weekly, the most popular non-commercial radio show in the city. Hank decided not to do any of the fascinating storytelling he did in private, preferring to let the music speak for itself. So it fell on me to do the interviews and study up on things I could add to make our broadcasts stronger. Hank had such a stupendously deep collection that there was hardly an artist who came through our gates who didn't discover records of their music that they had never seen before, primarily Peter Tosh, who became one of our biggest early supporters. The program was the first in a series of events, each building on the one before, that caused me to interact with virtually all of the major players in the Wailers' careers. Our first musical guest was Bob Marley. We had only been on the air for 6 weeks when Island Records called and asked if we'd mind going on the road for a couple of weeks on his survival tour. It was one of the most important events in my life, as we shared a wide variety of experiences, both public and private, with Marley and his band. We told Bob about our show, and he urged us to remember that reggae music was for education, not just jollification. Ironically, the happiest person on the road with us was the bus driver. He got to sweep up all the roaches at the end of each evening, and some nights he told us he'd go home with several ounces of discarded herb. During this period, Bob asked me to arrange for showings of the two most important films of his life at that point, Jeff Walker's documentary and film of the Smile Jamaica concert, and the assassination attempt on Bob's life that preceded it, and the One Love Peace concert film Heartland Reggae. He had seen neither of them before. During both screenings, it was instructive to watch Bob watching Bob, and some of his reactions described in this book are sure to be provocative. His final show in L.A. was a benefit concert at the Roxy, and Hank and I were among the very few allowed into the show's soundcheck that afternoon. Bob spent close to an hour singing something over and over again that we'd never heard before about redemption. It would be the last time we would see him before he passed a year and a half later from melanoma. Peter Tosh came through a few months later, saying grudgingly that at least Bob's death would make room for other artists to be noticed, a belligerent stance that cost him the support of many of his fans. But he had a very warm and humorous side to him, too, and over the next 7 years we grew close, and I interviewed him several times for Reggae Beat and also for a cable TV show that producer-director Chili Charles had started called L.A. Reggae. I would get several calls a year from Peter in various far-flung locations, asking for copies of this or that record. He didn't have any of his own history, he explained sadly. It had all been stolen or begged off. Just before his murder in September 1987, he called asking for a copy of Here Comes the Judge to remake for a sequel to his then-new album No Nuclear War. Bunny Wailer came into my life later. A recluse since his departure from the group in 1973, I first met him at the Sunsplash Festival in Montego Bay in 1985 and gave him 11 90-minute tapes of old Wailer singles. The following year, he called me and asked me to be the publicist for what would be his first foreign show after 13 on-island years of exile from overseas stages. That show was held in L.A., and he came on the Reggae Beat the next day for a 4-hour special. In 1990, Bunny again called, asking this time if I would be willing to co-write his autobiography. I readily accepted and requested that I bring along my dear friend Leroy Jody Pearson, a brilliant blues guitarist and historian and founder of the Nighthawk record label, which had already released some of Bunny's music. He agreed, and Leroy and I went on to spend 3 weeks locked in a hotel room in Kingston in October 1990, compiling 64 hours of interviews about the entire history of his relationship with Bob and Peter. Sadly, Bunny has never allowed that book to be published. 10 years of work and 1,800 pages of transcripts of the history that every Wailers fan is yearning to read remains in limbo. Nonetheless, Leroy and I combined over 30 years of research to complete our 2005 book, Bob Marley and the Wailers, The Definitive Discography, to date, the only true discography ever compiled for any Jamaican artist. In 1984, NARIS, the National Academy of Recording Arts and Sciences, asked me to organize and chair a Reggae Grammy Committee, which I did for the next 27 years. That same year, I was invited to do a presentation of unreleased Marley films and videos as part of the National Video Festival at the American Film Institute. This drew positive reviews in local press and led to invitations from colleges, and then clubs, to do it again. My multimedia program, The Life of Bob Marley, has been presented over 500 times all over the world since then, from the outback of Australia to the bottom of the Grand Canyon, bringing the words and works of reggae's prophet to the far reaches of the globe. This has led to hundreds of encounters with those who interacted with Bob personally, each of whose stories I taped or filmed for posterity. Many of these appeared in the Beat magazine, which was co-founded by me and C.C. Smith in 1981 and lasted for 28 years. Each May, I edited a Bob Marley Collector's Edition, which included writing by some of reggae's finest observers, all working for free for the love of the music. The Wailers Band and I have remained good friends for almost 4 decades now. In 2013, the family man Barrett-led Wailers invited me to go on the road with them for 2 months as their opening act as they played the entire Survival album live. I slept on the floor of their bus throughout January and February, working in some of the coldest cities in North America, showing pictures I took on the original tour and telling of the crucial importance of the album and explaining its lyrics. It left me with a lasting and enormous respect for the road life that these intrepid warriors have committed themselves to at great personal cost, carrying Bob's timeless creations to a hungry younger generation. Back in 2002, I approached Norton's Jim Mars with an idea for an oral history of Bob Marley. My original conception was for the complete transcripts of some 80 crucial interviews to be published in full, so that readers would know each person's whole story in their own words and see the context in which each question was answered. I wanted to present the raw material of history for writers in the future to have full access to. I had nearly completed the book by 2005 when disaster struck. Having been born in 1942, I'm definitely part of the techno-igno generation, and when my computer suffered an unfixable crash, I lost everything. The manuscript, the interview transcripts, and all my notes. I went into a 2-year funk and couldn't face starting from scratch again. When Jim came looking for the book in 2007, I had to confess what had happened. I am eternally grateful for his patience and understanding, and he urged me to get started again. A few years later, I sent him about 80% of the book. He wrote back that the folks at Norton had decided it would be far more readable if I broke up the voices into topics, in the manner of the superb biography Bill Graham presents by Robert Greenfield. With a heavy heart, realizing how much more work still lay before me, I agreed. Now I see that Jim's decision was the right one in so many ways, and I'm grateful for him standing by me with infinite patience and belief in the project. In 2015, Jim passed the project over to Norton's meticulous senior editor, Tom Mayer, himself a former reggae broadcaster in California and at Columbia. So, to answer the questions posed at the beginning, I have compiled this book with the knowledge that there are several superb books that deal with various portions of Bob's life, and I do not feel the urge to repeat previous works. Sadella Booker tells A Mother's Story about his childhood. Her ghostwriter, Tony Winkler, who told me once that he never listens to reggae and only likes classical music, helmed a tome that is curiously devoid of music, but does give valuable information about Bob's youth. For his years in Delaware, Christopher John Farley's Before the Legend fills in many blanks of that pre-island period. One of my very favorite books is John Missouri's brilliant Wailing Blues, the story of Bob Marley's Wailers, which is basically the autobiography of family man Barrett and his drummer brother Carlton, the very heart of the Wailers' sound since 1970. Every song done by Bob since then is deconstructed in this invaluable book. My friend Stephen Davis was one of the first out of the gate with Bob Marley, which gives a fine overview of Bob's life and remains justifiably in print after more than 30 years. Photographer Kate Simon covers the mid-70s years in her massive Rebel Music, which is filled with extraordinarily intimate photographs and reminiscences by several of those with whom she toured. Likewise, Chris Salowich's instructive 50th birthday coffee table book, Songs of Freedom, gives much detail on Bob's childhood and European touring. Vivian Goldman's exhaustive eyewitness account of the making of Marley's album of the century, The Book of Exodus, is a major work of scholarship. With all of these already on the shelves, what's left to add? With so much things to say, named after one of Bob's most evocative compositions, I have set out to illuminate with first-person depth the parts of his life that have been only partially explored. My main topics include his pre-recording years in Kingston, the backstage reality of Coxsone Dodd Studio One, his exile from Kingston in 1966 and 1967, the Danny Sims-Johnny Nash maneuverings of the late 60s and early 70s, the perilous history of the group's relationship with Lee Perry and the disquieting reasons for their split, the breakup of the group in 1973, the assassination attempt in 1976, an inquiry into whether the CIA was complicit in the attempt on his life, the controversial events leading to the One Love Peace concert, his trips to Africa, including shocking behind-the-scenes stories of Gabon and Zimbabwe, and the history of his fatal cancer and its treatment. Over the past 37 years, scores of his friends, associates, and family members have shared with me intimate details of their interactions with the Reggae King. Now you can read their revelations, too. There are many contradictory accounts, among them the controversy surrounding the recording of the Wailers' first record, Simmer Down, and the circumstances surrounding the wedding of Bob Marley and Rita Anderson. Let history decide. This is its raw material. There are some important omissions in this book which can't be helped. My biggest regret is never having had the chance to speak to Johnny Nash, whose influence on the Wailers from 1968 to 1972 is crucial to understanding the artist that Bob became. Bunny Wailer makes some astounding charges in these pages, and I tried over the decades to get Mr. Nash to respond. His people replied, as this book was about to go to press, "Over the many years that there have been numerous accounts of that time frame, John's posture has and continues to be that of not dignifying them with any sort of response. It would not serve a meaningful purpose other than giving a false platform to get attention. Those events are a part of history. They cannot be relived, and those who were part of creating the historical events of that era know the truth. Debating on any level for John would be counterproductive to serve a purpose for whoever's views are not on point. With all that being said, John sends his appreciation for your concerns, of misgivings, and wanting to give him a voice, but it's really not his style. He prefers to remain silent and let the records speak for themselves. Regardless, Johnny Nash has my utmost respect and admiration for his incredibly important work in exposing reggae to the masses and making vital contributions that molded Bob and the Wailers into finest quality international entertainers. There has never been an artist like Bob Marley, the artist of the century. His works are more popular than ever, with Forbes magazine listing him at number 5 among the highest-earning dead celebrities for 2014. Bob was psychic, and he declared that his work would last forever. It was just one of his many prophecies, some of which have yet to manifest. His abilities were recognized in 1976 by the Jamaican poet and author Jeffrey Philp, who wrote about meeting Bob for the first time at the Mona Heights Community Center in Kingston and reconfirmed them to me at a Marley seminar in Florida in 2015. When I got there, Bob was sitting under an acacia tree. I walked up to him, introduced myself, and he told me to sit down. This was the first time I had experienced Bob's so-called psychic ability, because he began to tell me things about my life that no one else, not even my mother, knew about me. I still don't remember the details because I was in a state of shock. I just couldn't believe that anyone upon meeting me within the space of 5 minutes could have told me so much about my life. Here now, his closest friends and associates tell you about the life of the Bob Marley they encountered. As one of the early readers of this manuscript observed, after reading this, I feel like I really know the man. My hope is that you will too. Chapter 1. Where is my mother? Roger Steffens. Sadella Malcolm Marley Booker, Bob Marley's mother, was 18 at the time of his birth. Her white husband, born in Clarendon, Jamaica, was named Norval Marley. He was around 64 when Nesta Robert Marley was born on February 6, 1945, in a tiny rural village called 9 Mile, which had no electricity or running water. Christopher Marley, a member of the White Marley family, has spent years tracing Bob's bloodline and has been sharing his research with me as new discoveries come to light, debunking many of the false claims that continue to this day, including the idea that Norval was born in England and was an army officer. Christopher Marley. Bob Marley's father was Norval Sinclair Marley, born to a British father and a colored mother. Norval was not a sea captain, nor was he a quartermaster or captain or officer in the British Army. He was a ferro cement engineer. His British Army discharge papers show that he worked in various labor corps in the UK during the First World War and was discharged as a private. He did not see active service on the battlefield. Norval Marley's family was not Syrian, as has been suggested. He was a restless, wandering man. He traveled and worked all over the world at a time when travel was not the simple thing it is today, to Cuba, the UK, Nigeria, and South Africa. He was supervising the subdivision of some rural land in St. Anne Parish for war veteran housing when he married 18-year-old Sadella Malcolm, whom he had got pregnant. He provided little financial support and seldom saw her and their son. He died of a heart attack in 1955, stone broke, and living off an 8-shilling-a-week army pension, about U.S. $1.20. Norval was seriously unstable, to put it mildly. The rejection of Bob by the Marley family was a rejection of Norval. Sadella Booker. Norval was living in 9 Mile at the time, watching the lands that the government gave people, certain amount of land to work on during the war. He was like an overseer. Roger Steffens. If there was any true direction in Bob's earliest years, it would come from his grandfather, Omariah, who was known locally as a Mayol man, a benevolent practitioner of healing arts, as opposed to an Obeah man whose darker intentions cast fear into the hearts of superstitious country folk. Omariah was reported to have fathered as many as 30 children. Sadella Booker. My father Omariah was a very spiritual person. He's like the Blackheart man, a practitioner of traditional healing methods. He's a man like when people sick, he can help them and give them medicine and things like that. He had his own medicine that him fix and mix and just cure people. Omariah taught Bob not to steal, to tell the truth, to obey. He owned enough land here and there and everywhere. Not no big great properties, but good parcels like 30 acres, 20 acres, 10 acres, 5 acres, all over the place. Bob moved donkeys, goats, carry food from up in the field to the home, send him ride the donkey and pick up corn, cut corn bush, and go feed the other animals. Them have to do manual work. We have to go to spring to get water. Roger Steffens. Bob's cousin Sledger, who was raised alongside him in 9 Mile, recalls that Bob was a fearless rider of his favorite donkey, Nimble, and could jump bareback over a 5-foot wall with ease, sometimes even doing it backward. He and Sledger loved music, and would listen especially on Sundays when Omariah would plug his radio into a generator and play it for the locals, tuning in to a Miami station. Elvis Presley, Fats Domino, and Ricky Nelson were early favorites of the boys. Bob's nascent musical instruction came directly from Sadella's dad. Sadella Booker. My father played organ, guitar, a little violin. Everyone in the family played music. My cousin Marcinine, he make a little banjo guitar and they put the string on it. That would be Bob's first instrument. And when he got bigger, he would start holding guitar. Sometimes he hum along with me on songs like Precious Lord, Take My Hand. Roger Steffens. At the age of 3, Bob began to evince intuitive powers of surprising accuracy. Sadella Booker. I remember when a woman we call Aunt Zen used to love to play with Bob as a little boy. So she came to the shop where I worked, and he started to read her hand and tell her some things, and she said, "Everything that the child tell me is right." Another man, Solomon Black, a district constable, he came to the shop and stopped by, and as a little boy, Bob take his hand and start to look at it, start to tell him some things, and whatever he told him, the man say, "You might be taking it for a joke, but everything the child tell me is right." Bob knew he wasn't going to be here for long, so he have to do what he have to do. I have this friend, Ibis Pitts. He was Bob's first friend that he made in Delaware in 1966. Ibis said that one day he and his friend Dion Wilson went over to the park where I used to live, and Bob climbed into a tree and that Bob said, "When I am 36, I am going to die." This was in 1969. Roger Steffens. Sadella Booker, affectionately known as Mother B, has visited my reggae archive several times over the years. Many of our conversations went unrecorded, although I made notes of each one afterward. In one, she recalled Norval showing up at 9 Mile when Bob was 5, asking that she allow Bob to come with him to Kingston so he could educate him and give him a shot at a better life. Sadella agreed, but when Norval and Bob arrived in Kingston, one of the only times they were together, instead of taking him home and enrolling him in school, Norval sent him to live with an elderly woman friend of his named Miss Gray. During the next couple of years, Bob was essentially an abandoned child on the streets of Kingston. Sadella would write Norville and ask when she could visit, but he discouraged her every attempt and told her the boy was in a boarding school in St. Thomas. Eventually, someone from 9 Mile recognized Bob on a Kingston street and told Sadella where he was, and she came and got him. Sadella Booker. Bob was about 5 when he went to Kingston, not quite 2 years when he came back, and Mrs. Simpson asked him to read her hand, and he said, "No, I'm not reading no more hand. I'm singing now." Roger Steffens. Neville O'Reilly Livingston, later to be known as Bunny Wailer, co-founded the Wailers. He first met Bob when they were both youngsters. Bunny Wailer. I was about 9 in 1957 when my father took me up to live in 9 Mile where I first met Bob. We moved, migrated. My father bought some land there, about 25 acres, built a house, built a shop. We stayed there about 9-10 months. I didn't live there too long, though. The place was too cold, very cold area. I wasn't prepared for that kind of cold. I used to get cramps in my stomach, so they had to ship me back to the city, and then a short time after that, Bob came to the city to live with his mother. Roger Steffens. As a youngster, Bob would explore the area around 9 Mile and sometimes went places he was forbidden to go. During one of these excursions, he cut open his right foot after stepping on a broken glass bottle. He was afraid to show the wound to his mother for fear of being punished, but it became infected and he was in great pain for months. Eventually, his cousin Nathan made a plaster of warm orange pulp and a yellow powder called iodoform, and within a couple of weeks the wound completely healed. This was the first of numerous wounds to the foot in which his fatal cancer would eventually take hold. Bunny Wailer. Bob was a wild child. He was like the ugly duckling. He had to find his own little brush to pick and his own little cornmeal. Nobody wanted him around their corn, so he'd get what's left. He just had to survive. His most serious endeavor was just to eat and drink. There were many nights of cold ground for his bed and rock stone for his pillow. Countless nights. Bob was not a child who get anything that he sought. He didn't get what any other child got. Roger Steffens. Bob's earliest years were filled with neglect and rejection by both races. Whites thought of him as a black child. Blacks, critical of mixed-race children, taunted him as the little yellow boy. Even his revered great-grandmother, known as Yaya, referred to him as the German boy. Racism was rampant in those days, and the light-skinned leaders of the country were deeply influenced by 300 years of British colonial rule. For Bob, his color seemed to be an impediment wherever he turned, causing him to turn inward, a solitary soul relying on his own inner strengths. Even more significantly, the rejection by his father weighed heavily on him throughout his life. His early sojourn in the city of Kingston, where he went weeks without a proper meal, steeled him for his return there when his mother left 9 Mile to join Bunny's father in 1957. Kingston would force the young Marley outward into a world of crowded slums and stimulating companions in a nation on the brink of overthrowing the yoke of imperialism. Chapter 2. Trenchtown Rocks. Roger Steffens. Once established in Kingston, Bob's mother entered into an on-again-off-again relationship with Bunny's father, Thaddeus Toddy Livingston. Their affair produced a daughter named Pearl, sister to Bunny and Bob, born in 1964. The music swirling in Bob's head was developed with the help of neighbors in Trenchtown, a crowded enclave near the edge of the port area, where so-called government yards, yard is a common Jamaican term for a house, had been erected to give poor people housing and running water. One of the first friends Bob made as a young teenager was a prize-winning singer named Seagree Wesley. He and I met in the studios of WBAI in New York City in May 2003, where we spoke for several riveting hours about the early days of Bob's training and his own short career. Seagree Wesley. I was raised in Trenchtown in the government yards. They had what were called L-shaped houses, which were one single room. But on every street, there was 6 double-decker houses, what you call upstairs houses, more than one floor. So my parents and the whole family, we lived in one of those on 16 Row First Street, Trenchtown. Bob Marley entered in my awareness in the early 60s, and when he came, I know for a fact he was at 3rd Street, same street as Joe Higgs and the rest. That's where I met him on Pipes, Winston Pipe Matthews of the Wailing Souls side. I heard the guys crooning in the back, because in Trenchtown, everywhere you go, there's always a little group. Groups that made it and groups that didn't make it. But I went over and I heard him singing. But they all knew me and knew who I was. And then after, he was living on 2nd Street, which was behind the yard I was living on 1st. And then I know when he was living with Bunny Wailer and Bunny's father, Toddy. And we were friends, and he would say, "Seagree, come, let's go rehearse." So we'd go and rehearse in the kitchen. But even then, my mom used to say, "Seagree, I don't want you hanging with those boys," because, of course, they weren't working people. They weren't even going to school. Roger Steffens. Trenchtown was known as a ghetto, and it was difficult for people from there to find jobs once potential employers discovered their address. Among the only ways that law-abiding people were able to escape were through sports or music, and the area was known as an incubator of great talents in both fields. One of the most important was Joe Higgs, among the earliest of Jamaica's recording artists, who became Bob Marley's most significant mentor. Higgs not only coached Bob, he was a musical teacher and guide to a host of other Jamaican artists, including superstars from the earliest days of ska and rocksteady, the predecessors of reggae. Today, he is widely regarded as the father of reggae. For almost 20 years before his passing in 1999, he lived in Los Angeles. I worked with him throughout the late 90s on his never-completed autobiography, from which his quotes in this book are taken. Joe Higgs. I first encountered Bob Marley when he was on 2nd Street and I was on 3rd Street. Bob was known as a very light-skinned chap living in the ghetto. People called him the Little Red Boy, and he would be beaten up by a lot of guys. This is when Bob and Bunny were living in Toddy's house with Sadella. A guy by the name of Errol Williams, whose father was a man who had a scrap iron yard on Spanish Town Road and Bread Lane near Backawall, used to tell me he'd like me to teach Bob Marley to sing and play music. Errol was like Bob's father and mother. He'd give him daily 10 shillings or a pound. A half-Indian guy from a family of the owners of Queen's Theater, King's Theater, and a Vineyard Town Theater. Errol was always a father figure to Bob, older. Errol was a very nice guy, wasn't doing anything to get anything back. He liked us both. It was as a favor, no money changed hands. He called him Robbie. "I want you to help Robbie," he said to me. We would meet early in the mornings, and whatever I did, soccer, go to the sea, he would be among us. I was always giving him insight into the music, how to use his breath control. Talking a lot of times is part of the whole thing. Teach him craft, technique, like I taught a lot of people. When I started with Bob, there was hardly any voice there. Roger Steffens. Intriguingly, Joe Higgs says Bob Marley lived next to Delroy Wilson, a famous child star of the ska and rocksteady era. Joe Higgs. When Bunny and Bob were growing up together, Bob was not treated as one of the family. He was like an outcast in the house. His mother today comes with this legacy as if she were there. Bob was sent to learn welding, while Bunny was sent to school. Toddy didn't put any money into Bob's corner. The mother, Sadella, wouldn't allow anybody to know he was her son. One day he was holding tightly to her, and she boxed him away. He slept beneath the bottom of the house. Seagree Wesley. In Joe Higgs' yard, we used to go like in the evenings. You'd come from school. I remember it wasn't actually where Joe Higgs lived. A lot of people say it's where Joe lived, but Joe is from 3rd Street. But the gatherings used to be on 2nd Street. And there was a guy, Skipper Lako. We used to go on his little veranda. And that's where we used to rehearse. Bob was really the least among the group, but he had more love for it than I've seen anybody have love for singing. He had the time, and he would get there, and like, he would be the first one. He didn't even know how to play guitar then, because the only guitarist in that little group that was formed, we didn't know the name of the group, they didn't even have a name yet, it was Peter. But Peter Tosh wasn't there at the start. There was Bob and the girls. When you went there, you'd hear other people singing with them. So I don't know if other people want to proclaim and say they were part of the group. Cardo Scott was among them, Junior Braithwaite, Bunny and Bob, every day together. Joe helped them. He used to mentor and, like, sort of tell them what to do and what not to do. Joe was helping him because Bob never really was a person who had any kind of excellent voice, per se, because even when the group became famous and started doing recordings, in my opinion, Bob had the worst voice of all. I think Bunny had the best voice of all of them. Roger Steffens. Ricardo Scott, also known as Ross Cardo, was raised in Trenchtown in that early time. He has written not only that he was an original Wailers member, but also that it was he who came up with the group's name. He has also claimed publicly that he invented the word reggae in 1962 by combining the patois word for a woman of the street, stregge, with the Latin rex regis, meaning king. So reggae was of the people, but also of King Selassie. It is questionable that this is true, particularly when one realizes how quickly new words are adopted in Jamaica. So a gap of 6 years or so between the creation of the word and its first use on the Maytals' Do the Reggae in 1968 seems to put the lie to Ross Cardo's claim. Joe Higgs. I would not oppose Cardo's belief that he was an early person around the Wailers. Today you have a set of kids and tomorrow two or three more, but to say he was an original member of Wailers, I contest that statement very, very strongly. I don't know of it. The lead singer was Junior Braithwaite, because it was not Bob who was leading. But Bob was the one who really put the group together, because through me, Bob did what he wanted to do, and I spearheaded his thought. I believe this group belonged to Bob Marley, not Cardo or anyone, not Errol the Indian guy who brought Bob to me. Cardo neither founded the group nor came up with the name. The Wailers came because I was teaching the kids, especially the boys, how to be accountable as individuals while we maintain a musical basis. It's not jazz they were learning. I was teaching them to wail. There were songs the Wailers did without Bob Marley. I have never heard that Cardo came up with the idea for the group to be called Wailers. Roger Steffens. Many other people have claimed credit for the Wailers' name and suggested various titles for the group. Bunny's memory of their adoption of the name Wailers is quite mystical. Bunny Wailer. That's another mystery now. This is how it went. We always had in mind to call ourselves like maybe the Teenagers or Roosters. One specific day, me can remember Joe Higgs cook a nice pot of cowcod soup, soup made with a bull's penis, while we were rehearsing in a kitchen there. And the spirit was high. We were closer to going into the studio now. Everybody say, Wailers ready, ready, but we never have the name yet. So everybody did call names, you, and suggest names, and it's like a man was there next door or in a bathroom or something, and we just hear a voice that say, the Wailers. And every man say, the Wailers. The Wailers? The Wailers. The Wailers? No one know which voice or which man say the Wailers, because him don't show him face. Him just say the Wailers, and a big strong voice say the Wailers. Everybody hear that, and them start to say, the Wailers. The Wailers. Everybody heard that. That sound good, weeping and wailing, because we'll weep, because we are in Trenchtown there and we feel the pain. So the Wailers fit. You think that a joke thing? Think that the name Wailers a joke? Look here. That what the name Wailers mean. Wailing means to suffer, to cry, to bawl, to you name it. And who go through the dark like the Wailers? Who go through sufferation? So the name Wailers wasn't a name that was given to the Wailers by an individual who would come now and get credit. Who is he that can say that? Who is he that can say he was responsible for giving the name? Not even a Wailer. We hear a voice bawl out, the Wailers! Every man remember that. And we did our first session right after that, like about the next week. Roger Steffens. To wail in Jamaican terms meant to cry out for justice, to beseech the Almighty and the powers that be for a better life. It was not just crying, it was imploring from the depth of your soul, stripped of all pretense and inhibition. As Joe Higgs says, everyone is capable of wailing, like a gospel concept. One of those who recognized early on the potential power of the group was the movie star handsome Alan Skill Cole, a soccer star in Jamaica who became Bob's closest friend and sometime business associate. He was a frequent guest at the Trenchtown home of a charismatic Rastafarian named Mortimer Plano, who kept a library of Black Power books and Rasta tracts in his house. Plano would become deeply involved in Marley's career following his return from America in late 1966. Alan Skillcole. I first met Bob probably about 12 years of age over at Mortimer Plano's house in 1962. In those days, at that time, I was going to Kingston College, a high school. I had schoolmates that lived in that area, Trenchtown, so we sometimes, like on a weekend, would pass through and look for them guys. Mortimer Plano was a very famous man in Trenchtown, Rasta man, Rasta leader in the area. And we, as youth seeking to know certain things, pass through, so we get to know Plano. The Bob I knew and I met in the very early 60s was a very, very shy young man. He was the type of person that when you look at him, you think you were seeing someone who was afraid of even speaking with people. Very, very timid. He was so quiet, well-reserved, but a very warm young man. Very, very artistic, very creative. Roger Steffens. The Wailers group began to coalesce through informal rehearsals in the early 60s. Joe Higgs. I started to teach the Wailers to sing harmony, structuring, and all those different things, basic principles of singing, how to try to preserve as much energy as you can. And I had the Wailers on a certain level at that time. Sometimes they would be doing good, but every now and again someone would make a slip in my presence. Roger Steffens. Higgs believed they weren't ready to record yet, but Bob felt the desire to sing so strongly that he auditioned as a solo artist for the Beverly's label, owned by a sharply dressed, well-groomed producer named Leslie Kong. Bunny tells the story of the roundabout way Bob came to meet Kong. Bunny Wailer. When he left school, Bob began working at a big welding shop. He was learning a trade same time, welding, getting maybe 15 shillings or a pound a week, depending on how Millard the boss felt. One time, Bob had a flash when the spark flies from the welding iron, got him in the eye, and he cried day and night. And when he went into the sun, he had to wear glasses. Then he had to have a cap on his nose to take even the glare of the sun off the glass because his eyes would just run. A lot of pain, like gravel in your eye. When you squint, it's like gravel sticking you under the eyelid and down the ball. Both eyes! We treated it with an herb we called bissy, a popular panacean Jamaican herb that is rubbed on or preferably made into a tea. But that event kind of made him want to stop working in the welding. Desmond Decker, a preeminent rocksteady singer, had been working at the same welder's place and encouraged Bob into going into the studios. He introduced Bob to Beverly's Leslie Kong. Decker had recorded Honor Your Mother and Your Father. Then Bob went in and cut Judge Not, his first record, with Do You Still Love Me on the B-side. I was there when Terror was cut, the second unreleased session. I was to have been on the session to do Pass It On, but I was late. Bob got 20 pounds, and he bought some good clothes. Roger Steffens. Unfortunately, Judge Not and its follow-up One Cup of Coffee, a cover of a country and western song by Claude Gray, failed to capture the public's attention. Pass It On would not appear until more than a decade later. Russ Michael. In 1963, when Bob drew his first record, Judge Not, Bob was like a little youth in him own style. The vision within Bob was a fullness already, and it led to his most important works like One Love and Them Bellyful. Roger Steffens. Russ Michael was another early supporter. Considered by many to be the most important Rastafarian musician in Jamaica, Russ Michael is the natural inheritor and defender of Rasta dogma, which suffuses the tradition of Nyabingi music, a style first popularized by the foundational group Count Ossie and the Mystic Revelation of Rastafari. He was a lifelong friend of the Wailers and played the penultimate set of 1978's historic One Love Peace Concert between Peter Tosh and Bob Marley. We spoke at the Reggae Archives in December 2011. Russ Michael. Joe Higgs was the maestro of a lot of things, not just only Bob alone, but most men, because Joe comes like he was a very stern teacher in enough things. Many a time he say, "Man, you're not hitting that note right." He coached most of the trios. From you there and sing, him going to get involved in the perfection of certain things, what will make you be elevated. show you how to hit a note, all of that. Him not going to get paid for that. Me older than Bob is, yes, but not much older years than him. The whole of us grow in a certain place, because Bob Marley's mother and my mother were higglers. Higglers are people who sell in the market, Ewart Street, Princess Street. Bob was a loving spirit, brother. When them come, everybody just irie, joyful, in them own vibration. We had that communical spirit of love within our own self. Because I remember Peter Tosh, Bunny Wailer, Bob Wailer, Junior Braithwaite, the originals. Man and man were just like brothers. When we see each other, you see a man's 32 teeth, because his pure smiles, happiness, whoppin' man, whoppin'. And Bob say, yeah, man, everything all right. We did have that love that money can't buy, priceless. We share things. Our togetherness was our richness. It never took money to make we rich. The togetherness alone bring that richness among we. Oxford Street and Salt Lane, back a wall, were like playgrounds. I remember one of the time, Bob did have a little record shop on Beeston Street near King Street Corner, just a little teeny thing. We laugh, me and Peter and him sit down upon a step in front of the shop and record blast. Not even one record sell in them days. But we organized. It's like we achieved the message at the time that we want to see come out. And people step and snap their fingers and we feel the vibes. So we're happy for the things that the Almighty allow us to put to the people. Although at that time no great dividends. But we know we score a goal already. Because from the people start listen, them guys start react. Because it is the truth. It is the roots of the people. It is the heartbeat for the people. Roger Steffens. Peter Tosh was one of the final additions to the group. Raised on the remote western end of the island in Westmoreland, he arrived in Kingston at the age of 15 with great optimism about the musical path he wished his life would take. The Wailers were impressed because he had his own guitar, which none of them had as yet, and because of his militant attitude. Peter Tosh. I was born in the country, Westmoreland. I didn't live with my mother, but I am my mother's only child. And I didn't grow with her. I was grown with my mother's aunt, my grand-aunt, when I was 3 years old until I was 15. But she never had a lot of influence in my life. I was 3 years in size, but 50 years old in the mind, seen? Because I was born with a matured mind, and born with a concept of creativity. And any time there's a controversy within me, it create an inner conflict, seen? And any time that inner conflict is created, something is wrong, so you must internally investigate it. I grew up with that mind. I was born, raised in righteousness. Not to say that my parents was righteous, because they did not know what was righteousness. They were being led away to a shitstem, his word for system, or being deceived by deceivers, you see, because they wanted to know what was righteousness. I left Westmoreland at 15 to learn. Music was playing me from such time. I was born in music. From ever since I could talk and exchange verbal thoughts, I could sing. The first instrument I ever played was a guitar. I made it out of a piece of board, sardine can, and some plastic line, the plastic you use for fishing. Get good sound, too. When I left for Kingston, all I took was my little grip and some food to eat on the way and meself and jaw in my heart. Joe Higgs. Peter came from the country when we were living in Trenchtown. He had some family that were cabinet makers, and they used to sell syrup. That's how I first saw him. He used to sleep in the cabinet shop sometimes, but he was introduced to me by Bob Marley. Bunny Wailer. Peter was a revolutionary. Peter was a man arrogant, outspoken, no really worry about if him head a go cut off if him make certain statements. He wasn't an actor. Everything that he stood for from the early stage, he was really serious about. He was very conscious of Africa from an early stage. Peter make you laugh for a million different reasons. Peter loves to touch girls, pinching and squeezing them. You know, that's a serious kind of joke still. You see Peter touch a girl going down the road with her husband, gazes in her eyes in a split second that she almost broke her toe because this tall, dark, and handsome man touches her and gazes that she almost slips. Roger Steffens. His habit brought him the nickname Peter Touch, a name that even appeared as a credit on several of his recordings. Bunny Wailer. Peter just loved to fool around, and we just laugh, pure laugh. Anytime Peter come, there is something to laugh about, because him always have a story to tell you about something what just happened, when seed happen, or something he just hear. He always have a drama, always a laugh, a pure laugh. Seagree Wesley. I know Peter when he used to come from West Road. Peter was always the type who always portray a sort of rough image. We always used to say, Peter, you're resolute. Peter's not the type to listen to reasoning. He'll tell you whatever he wants to tell you, but he ain't listening to what you have to say. Which was the opposite of Bob. If you say something to Bob, he'll listen, and he'll talk back to you, and you'll converse with him for hours. But Peter is not one like that, with the kind of patience, you know. As a matter of fact, one day I look at him and I say, I think Bunny is more Rastaman than all of you guys. Roger Steffens. By early 1964, Bunny, Bob, and Peter would join with Junior Braithwaite and a pair of female singers to form the nucleus of a group that would change Jamaican music and bring the Wailers and reggae to worldwide attention. Chapter 3. The Wailers at Studio One. Roger Steffens. After the failure of Marley's two solo singles on Leslie Kong's Beverly's label, Joe Higgs helped shape the group of eager but raw vocalists into a quintet ready to enter the ranks of professional recording artists. Together, they were drawn to Kong's biggest rival, Studio One, owned by producer and sound system proprietor Clement Coxsone Dodd. At the time, June 1964, Coxsone was one of the most powerful dons of the music business. Though his reputation was mixed, with some artists questioning his fairness, he was respected as a consistent hitmaker. His studio band was the Scatolites, the inventors of ska, and they would play behind the Wailers from their very first session onward, an incredible break for these inexperienced teenagers. Their first release, Simmer Down, skyrocketed to number one and a reported 80,000 sales, marking the group's initial flowering as professional musicians. But despite recording scores of songs over the next 2 years, they would end up parting with the producer in frustration over a lack of proper recompense for their efforts. Dodd's name is often spelled Coxsone, but I have used Coxson in this book. In his studio on Brentford Road in Kingston in 2003, he explained the difference to me. Coxsone Dodd. Well, when it's me, it's Coxsone. When it's the label or the sound system, it's Coxsone. Roger Steffens. He then proceeded to autograph an early Wailers 7-inch record, Coxsone Dodd. Coxsone Dodd. Somebody gave me that name. There was a cricket side in England. It was popular. One of its stars was a man called Coxsone, so they just labeled me that way, like making some wonderful catches. Roger Steffens. In 1983, I visited Coxsone's mother, Mrs. Darlington, at her shop in Spanish Town, just west of Kingston. She recalled her son working in the fields of Florida in the early 50s, picking crops and buying records for her to play on one of Jamaica's first sound systems. At the time, Mrs. Darlington was the girlfriend of another early Jamaican producer, Duke Reed, who had already begun to supply records to her. It was extremely rare to find a woman behind the turntables at that time, so she is considered a groundbreaker. As the 50s drew to a close, Coxsone also began to produce records by local artists for use at his dances. Mrs. Darlington had fond memories of those pioneering days, referring to her son respectfully as Mr. Dodd. Mrs. Darlington. Mr. Dodd played the radio in the night until 3 o'clock in the morning, listening to various singers. His favorite was Billy Eckstein. When he started the company, he generally traveled, and I was in charge of the whole operation, supervising the studio and the factory and the office, at times even a talent scout. Bob Marley started in the early 60s, and he was a young chap at that time, 16, 17, and he came to the studio and Mr. Dodd interview him. He found that his sound was okay, and he started to record him, and he brought his wife in, and they got Marley right in there. Mr. Dodd married the both of them. Coxsone Dodd. My mother has been of great help to me. She was the first person to operate my sound system. A woman DJ. When I worked in the States in the early 50s, I used to send a lot of records to Jamaica, and that's how my mother started operating the sound called Coxsone's Downbeat. I had a Bogan amplifier, about 35 watts, had some English-made speaker, Celestion 12-inch. They could take a lot of beating and things like that, along with some university horns to carry the sounds. My mother, Mrs. Darlington, would spin the records. Roger Steffens. Jamaican radio in the 50s was limited to a kind of cable radio system called RJR Rediffusion, or more properly, Radio Jamaica and Rediffusion Network, which played mostly foreign music. Local tunes in a nascent recording industry were limited to cover songs and calypsos, music identified with Trinidad, which originated the form. It was left to mobile discos known as sound systems to give exposure to ambitious young Jamaican creators. Joe Higgs. Before Bob Marley, the sound system's kings of those days were Count Nick the Champ, Tom the Great Sebastian, Rodericks, Deans, Skyrocket, and V-Rocket. All of these were before Duke Reed and Coxsone. Roger Steffens. Sound system clashes were held between competing systems. The ones with the better records drew the bigger crowds. They often battled sonically at different ends of a field as the crowd drifted between them, searching for the hottest shots of the moment. The bigger the crowd, the more drinks you could sell and the more money you could make. Sometimes, particularly in the early 60s, the clashes would end up in violence, as thugs associated with one or another of the entrepreneurs would mosh up, destroy their opponent's equipment, or terrorize their audiences. Joe Higgs. The first 11-sound contest that Reed and Coxsone entered into, Duke was third, Coxsone fourth, to Nick the Champ first, and Tom the Great Sebastian second. The contest was at Charles Street and Spanish Town Road. It's a yard on a corner with a fence around it. When I was about 15, Coxsone, we used to call him Downbeat, had a little sound, and he always come to a family whose name was Tucker, Harold, Keithy, Leslie, Eddie, Gladstone, Desmond. All these are brothers, and the most famous one, Jimmy. Coxsone used to come by and serenade, play in that yard, gospel music like Be There When I Come. You could stand outside and listen, but almost all of the sounds had their speakers in a tree up in the air or on a light post. Big speaker horn, sound draw people. I could hear Coxsone from miles away. You follow the sound. Duke Reed had a better sound, but Coxsone had better selections. During that time, Bob, Seco Patterson, and me used to hang together most of the time from Trenchtown to Back of Wall in different ghettos. Roger Steffens. Working under the stern tutoring of Higgs, the early nucleus of the Wailers included Junior Braithwaite, Cherry Green, Bunny Livingston, Peter Tosh, and Bob Marley, with several others from the neighborhood sitting in at various times. Joe Higgs. Junior did have the best voice in the group, I'm positive. Definitely. Bob had no voice. In those days, Junior was withdrawn. He stuttered. But he had a very nice voice. He was a very good singer, there from the start of the group's training. He had a voice like Frankie Lyman, appealing. It Was Your Love, It Hurts to Be Alone were his leads. That latter one had Ernest Ranglin on lead guitar, and it was one of the Wailers' biggest songs. Junior was related to my partner, Roy Wilson. Cousins, perhaps. Junior's father was a politician, Zebedee Braithwaite, who supported the elder Manley. Roger Steffens. Junior's parents migrated to the U.S., so he left with them shortly after the group began recording for the Studio One label in 1964. I spoke with him in Chicago in 1985, one of the only interviews he ever granted. Junior Braithwaite. I was born in Kingston, Jamaica, on April 4, 1949, on 3rd Street and West Road. That is in the heart of the ghetto. People now know it as Rima, the jungle. I was living on 3rd Street, and Bob Marley was living on 2nd Street. Joe Higgs was also on 3rd Street. My grandmother raised a youth named Roy Wilson. We were like brothers. Roy Wilson and Joe Higgs were the number one best harmonizing group in Jamaica at that time, and they used to rehearse in the back of our yard. So we as kids hang out around them, because we had something in common because we loved singing. Singing was a natural gift. I know that I was ordained to be a musician. Bob, Bunny, Peter, and myself, along with a sister, Beverly Kelso, as an early Wailer, The five people in the original Wailers are really Bunny, Bob, Peter, Beverly, and myself. And the Wailers was like just a singing group, a harmonizing group. We had nothing to do with instruments. So the commercial Wailers that you had touring later with Bob was like a group of musicians that he needed to back him up, and he called the Wailers. But they aren't the original Wailers. We grew up in roots and culture. We was born in it. And we, as a people, then, were closely knitted in a social atmosphere. To do anything, whatever projects at any time that we would undertake, would be easy because it was just a vibe of oneness. We weren't so clinging to material things. We were like, everything seemed so easily done, so natural to us, in that spiritually we were at our highest level, and we could so easily do anything. Roger Steffens. In addition to Junior, there were two women who sang with the Wailers in their early stages of recording. I tried for over 20 years to get Cherry Green, real name Ermine Bramwell, and Beverly Kelso to speak on the record with me. Although the material on which they appear has never been out of print since the mid-60s, they never made a penny for their work and were angry because of that. Finally, in May 2003, my friends the Midnight Ravers, broadcasters on WBAI in New York City, arranged for Cherry to fly up from her home in Florida and for Beverly to come in from her home in the Bronx to speak with me privately and, in Cherry's case, live on the air. Cherry Green. I was born in Upper Trenchtown, August 22, 1943. Ermine Bramwell was my original name, my father's name. My father was a dentist who died in the late 50s. Cherry was just my little nickname, because my skin was red, so they called me Cherry. I guess my mother called me that. My brother's last name is Green. I guess the boys know that, so that's why they call me Cherry Green. I went to Trenchtown School, and I went to a private school, too. My father lived in Jonestown off Oxford Street. We lived there. He'd do his work there. So after he died, we moved down to Trenchtown. My mother got one of the rooms, and we lived there. We was poor, but we was happy. I mean, never dirt poor that we couldn't go to eat, you know. We always have something to eat and always have something clean to wear. We had bicycle. My father used to take me to school in his car or on his motorcycle. He had two motorcycle when he died and a car. We used to have a big radio. You played a record on top. So every Saturday evening when Duke Reed came over the radio, I would turn that up so the neighborhood could hear. He'd play all the hit songs. I used to be in school play, and we always sing. I always try to stay on the back burner, kind of shy. But I'd be doing something, and I'd be singing just like when I sing with the Wailers. I used to listen to Harry Belafonte, Nat King Cole, Duke Ellington, and those kind of big band people. Joe Higgs was the one who discovered me. He used to sing, and we used to listen to him, and he would tell us little things. One day I was washing clothes, and I was singing an American song. I can't tell you what it was, but my voice was way up there, and he stopped immediately. He said, "Cherry, that's you?" So I said, "Yeah." So then I guess when Bob needs somebody, when Braithwaite left, they get me. Trenchtown, you know, we had nice people live there, but people just sometimes drift away. They migrate to England or to the U.S. We had good people from out of that little area. They make it look so bad now when I see the houses. It wasn't like that when we was growing up. It wasn't like that at all. Most people come from the country. They don't have running water. They don't have electric light. There you come. You have nice bathroom, toilet, kitchen. And we keep it clean, because I tell my boss, in my country, as poor as we are, people have one room, and when you look underneath the bed, you can see your face. It's clean. The Wailers always rehearse, and we were always there. You know, sit around with them rehearsing, and we would try to butt in and try to sing. Sometimes you go up too high, and Joe Higgs would say, he was like a teacher, he'd tell us what to do to bring the notes out and that kind of thing, technique. He was like that because he knew all of that. We just sing, you know. Joe was a boasty kind of guy because he always dressed nice. See, Joe went to Mico Teachers College, so I guess he probably learned all of that from there, you know. When Bob first come, we used to call him Little White Boy because his hair was curly. He was a teenager, him and Bunny. They used to dress nice in the Fifth Avenue shoes and nice shirt. Bunny and Bob, Peter, when they started down 3rd Street and West Road. They used to sit on the sidewalk and sing by the branch yard run by the JLP, the right-wing Jamaican Labor Party, where they have meetings. So they just sit down there singing with Cardo and the boys, but like we was girls. I mean, we pass and hear them singing, but when they start coming in the yard, that's when we would go, and then Peter come with his guitar. My earliest memory of Bob, the little girls, like before Rita, come and used to like him, because he used to come over by me, so then Rita get to come over by me so she could see him. We didn't call him Bob, we called him Lester, a variation of his birth name Nesta. That's what we know him as. Nice boy. He was funny, cracking jokes, teasing. Oh, yes. He used to be shy, though. You know, kind of shy. But I don't remember Bob being picked on. Roger Steffens. By now, all the supporting cast was in place. Under the direction of Coxsone Dodd, they would have their first release, beginning a steady string of hits, joining the ranks of the most important vocal groups on the island. One of the biggest puzzles over the years has been to ascertain the circumstances of the first Wailers recording. Most observers credit Simmer Down as the first recording and release, but there is wide disagreement among its participants as to the exact details. Percussionist Alvin Seco Patterson, who was close to Bob throughout his life, from his early Trenchtown days forward, spoke to me in the summer of 2012 and was precise in his recounting of the momentous day. In his telling, the Wailers went to Coxsone Dodd for a Sunday afternoon audition, sent there at his urging. Alvin Seco Patterson. The Wailers come back to me from audition and tell me, say, Mr. Dodd turned them down. So me take them back there right away and ask the man, why you turn them down, man? Him say him couldn't hear nothing. So me say, Simmer Down. And Mr. Dodd get a smile on his face and say, I like that. Play that. And when him hear it, he sent me to find Roland Alfonso, the saxophone player, and when we come back, him take us right into the studio and we record the song that night. Next day, then play it on soft wax on a sound system in Jonestown. Roger Steffens. In a prior interview, backstage at the Universal Amphitheater in Los Angeles in 1991, Seco gave a longer version. Alvin Seco Patterson. Bob and me was close. Very close. It was a spiritual thing. From he was very young, he was planning to sing to people. And then he find me musically, and so him say, boy, he figure I was the best person to take him to Coxsone, so we planned for that, you know. At that time, there was a little friction between Bob and Joe Higgs, and between Coxsone and Joe, some whole heap of things. So Joe prefer me to take him. But that day, it wasn't so nice, because when he went down there, Coxsone put him off for a next while. But I wasn't there. I never went. I was cooking. I send him and the boys. And he come back and say Coxsone put him off for a couple of more weeks. And he come and say, oh, Coxsone is fuckery, you understand? He can't deal with Coxsone. So I say, no, sir. And I ask him, what is the tracks he do? So him name the songs what him do. So I say, no, you don't do the right songs, right? You should do certain songs like Simmer Down, because we had just finished Simmer Down, you know? So him say, boy, me never think of that, you know. So I say, come. We go back up there the same day, man. Me say, Coxsone, you know, you don't listen to the man good. The man didn't do all the songs. Him say, then him have any more songs? I say, yeah, man, a lot of songs him can do. So I say, Simmer Down. And him say, Simmer Down, what is that? I say, one of the track them. Him say, make I hear that one. And him do Simmer Down. And that was it. Roger Steffens. Bunny Wailer tells a different version of the story. Bunny Wailer. We sang about four songs before we actually went to Simmer Down. Coxsone wasn't as turned on, so I said, why don't we sing Simmer Down? And Peter started playing Simmer Down even before Bob even answered. Peter started playing the rhythm, so I start singing. We didn't even sing the song through. We didn't even sing a verse before Coxsone said, okay, that one. You come tomorrow and we'll record that one first. Coxsone Dodd. Bunny Wailer claims they recorded Simmer Down the day after the audition. I say, no, no. You know why it couldn't be the next day? They had songs that was all do-over material, so I instructed them to try and do some writing. So that evening we started and we found a topic and we set up It Hurts to Be Alone. They came in for a rehearsal after that. Then we sent for guitarist Ernest Ranglin, got them together. But it took some time for them because all they had was like their early doo-wop stuff. But I was very impressed with them the first time because I was hoping to really get a kind of group with that teen feel, young voices, and thing like that. People say that Junior had the best voice. Well, that was definitely so. It's after he left that I demand that Bob do the lead. Roger Steffens. Cherry concurs with Coxsone, recalling that although Simmer Down was the group's first hit, there were a couple of songs before that. Joe Higgs appears to support Seiko's version. Coxsone gave an expanded explanation in an interview at his studio in Brooklyn in 1993. Coxsone Dodd.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.